You know, for us, we want Sunday morning to just be a time where someone can come and just be here. They don't have to be something. They can just come. And we're really intentional about creating moments throughout the morning that are life-giving. No matter where they are in their spiritual journey, there's something that helps them or moves them forward in life. In fact, we hope that when they leave here at the end of that hour, that they would look back on it and just say, that was an hour that fed my soul. It did something good for me in preparing the week, or it gave me a moment to explore God or spiritual things in a truly authentic way that was life-giving.
Outside for Christmas this year, we really wanted to create something that was nostalgic. We wanted to create something that felt like Christmas at home. We wanted an opportunity to have friends and family and loved ones come together and really celebrate what Christmas is all about and do that together. And so we have things outside like hot chocolate and a winter wonderland where we'll have falling snow, and our kids who don't typically get to experience snow during Christmas time can go out there and enjoy that. We have a photo booth that families can go and have their picture taken and take a picture home with them. Our kids have written us Merry Christmas notes that they want us to have. We have a Casas Christmas tree that families can help decorate. We really hope that these moments become memories that we can all look back on and enjoy.
I was so excited when I found out that we were doing Wham City for Christmas Eve this year, because I actually got to experience it at an event that we went to. It was right before we went on a break, and they said, everybody, download this app. You're going to need it. It's free. Just search in your app store for Wham City Lights. Download it, close it out, and then come back. Everybody's going to need it. So we didn't exactly know what was going on, but we all downloaded it. And so we came back from break and the music started and they said, okay, open up your app and hold up your phone facing forward. So we did, and we're just kind of waiting. And then all of a sudden it was just the coolest thing. We were all just looking around and taking it all in because it was really like nothing we'd ever seen before. And it somehow just made that huge room feel so much smaller and brought everybody together. And it was just a really cool way to end the evening.
Well, good evening. It's great to, Merry Christmas to you. It's great to have all of you here. How many of you still have a little Christmas shopping to get done? Well, we'll end on time so you can get out there. Maybe I'll join you. I finished all my Christmas shopping this morning. Did it all on eBay. The shipping could be a problem for tomorrow morning, but other than that, no. It is so good to have all of you here on this wonderful Christmas Eve, and we've got some wonderful festivities going on outside, so when you leave the service, make sure you take some of that in. In fact, it will be snowing in Kid City, is a rumor that I heard. So take in all of that, and we thought we'd start the night off with some memories of Christmas and something classic and that would kind of pull in a nostalgic feel. And so we've asked a very special family to come and share some of their traditions and start us off with some carols. And of course, this is the Binkman family. So will you help me welcome the Binkman family here? There they are.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Ted.
I'm Annie.
Son, that's your cue.
Nick.
And I'm Haley.
Merry Christmas from all of us in the Binkman family. You know, looking back over the many Christmas seasons gone by, there's one tradition that holds a special place in our hearts.
And we are so happy to be able to share that with you this evening. It's the Binkman Christmas Carols. It means it's time to sit back, relax, and enjoy some Christmas classics. The stockings are hung, the in-laws can't make it this year, and all the shopping is done.
The shopping isn't done.
Oh, Nicholas, it's done. It's
nope.
Christmas Eve.
Dad's supposed to go to the mall and get you a gift.
Oh, Nicholas, always making jokes about conversations we had in private.
Whatever. You just told me that backstage. You were like, don't tell Mom, but I still got to get her a Christmas gift.
Okay, well, we are so happy to be here. Thank you for having us this evening. And now I would like to invite you all to sing in this Christmas classic.
Still to buy my gift?
Okay. Oh, really? Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer had a very shiny nose. And if you ever saw it, you would even say it glows.
Like a light bulb.
All of the other reindeer.
Isn't she great, folks?
Used to laugh and call him names.
Like Pinocchio.
They never let poor Rudolph join in any reindeer games.
Great job. Sweetheart, it's you. Annie.
Then one foggy Christmas Eve, Santa came to say,
ho, ho, ho.
Rudolph, with your nose so bright, why would you wait until tonight?
Okay. Oh, how the reindeer loved him as they shouted out with glee.
Yippee.
Rudolph, the red-nosed reindeer, you'll go down in history. Man, don't you just love Christmas in the old Pueblo?
Nope.
Oh, come on, Nicholas. Where's your Christmas spirit?
Probably at the mall with my gift.
Okay, we don't need to talk about that anymore. Let's sing!
I want to wish you a Merry Christmas. I want to wish you a Merry Christmas. I want to wish you a Merry Christmas from the bottom of my heart.
Feliz Navidad.
Beautiful, sweetheart. I love it.
Feliz Navidad.
Adorable, right? I know.
Feliz blah blah blah. Yo quiero año y Fabrizi blah.
Keep doing that Spanish homework, Nick.
I want to wish you a Merry Christmas. I want to wish you a Merry Christmas. I want to wish you a Merry Christmas from the bottom of my heart.
I just want a dog.
Doing a great job.
A cute puppy dog.
Mommy has allergies, though. Won't work.
And if not a dog, I guess I would settle for an iPad.
I bet she would.
But every year she gets all the best gifts.
Nicholas, not now.
And every day is like a Haley's Christmas.
It's not usually like this.
Come on and drop some dough on your son, Nicholas. How about a brand new car? Oh.
Sorry, son, but all the gifts have been purchased this year.
away in a manger, no crib for a bed. The little Lord Jesus laid down his sweet head.
Ted, I think we really need to speak.
The stars in the bright sky looked down where he lay. The little Lord Jesus asleep on the hay.
Seriously, Ted.
The cattle are lowing, the poor baby wakes. But little Lord Jesus, no crying he makes.
This is so like you to avoid conflict.
I love thee, Lord Jesus. Look down from the sky and stay by my side till morning is nigh.
Done yet?
We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
A Beekman family photo! Come on!
We wish you a Merry Christmas. Wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year!
Is that your parents? I thought you said they weren't coming this year.
Say cheese! Well, you've just gotta love
love the Binkman family, right? Because they make my family and your family feel so normal all of a sudden, right? And they remind us a little bit of just the fact that Christmas time and family and life is a little crazy sometimes. And no family is perfect and life isn't perfect. And one of the things that we hope that you'll pick up as we roll on through the Christmas Eve service here this evening is that even the very first Christmas wasn't perfect and serene in everything, that it was also a little messy. One last thing here is for us to just take a moment to maybe greet some people around us. And I'm just looking at this audience here. And what a handsome, good-looking group of people you are here tonight. Your Christmas outfits and everything. So why don't you turn and greet someone and say, "My, you look good on this Christmas Eve," or something like that. So go ahead and say hello to the people around you.
Let's all stand together. You can stay standing. We're going to sing "Joy to the World." Sing it out.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare Him room. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing.
Of me. Christmas, just like the ones I used to know, where those treetops listen and children listen to hear sleigh bells in the snow, but in night.
Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloth and placed him in a manger because there was no room available for them at the inn.
That was my buddy Gavin right there. Good job. You know, when you think of the Christmas story, it is a story that is filled with wonder and beauty and even a sense of strength and grace. But it's not a story that is necessarily simple or clean. When you think about the story itself, right, there's Herod, and he puts forth this decree, and suddenly the whole world is scrambling, including Joseph, who has to go back to his village and explain this to his fiancée, Mary, right? Mary, you know, it's kind of bad news, good news. The bad news is when you're about 9 months pregnant, you're going to have to travel the better part of a week down to Bethlehem. But the good news is, I got you a donkey. Yeah, you get to ride a donkey for the better part of a week when you're 9 months pregnant. You know, that just couldn't have been a good conversation. I've had bad conversations in my house, but, you know, that's not one I would like to have with my wife there. And the way this would work is that when Caesar makes this proclamation, literally everybody in the entire known world has got to drop whatever they're doing, including work, their source of income, what they would be doing out in the field or wherever it would be, and they would have to travel back, no matter how far it was, to the city of their family origin, kind of back to their hometown. What he's doing is he's making everybody in the whole world live with their relatives for a while. I mean, think about this. This is like Caesar woke up one morning and was just like, what can I do to put the whole world in a bad mood? I know. I'll make them live with their own family. Yeah, we'll do that. And they won't make any money during this time. And so picture Mary at the end of it would take her close to a week to make this journey all the way from Nazareth down to Bethlehem. She walks into the door of a home that would someday soon be her own relative's home. See, they've gone back to Bethlehem, and they're going to be staying with Joseph's relatives. And you have to know, this is a culture where, like, one of the worst social faux pas you can be a part of would be to be a young woman who is pregnant and unmarried. And here's Mary, and she walks through the door, and here are Joseph's aunts and uncles and cousins and second cousins and grandparents, and they're all there. And, you know, they walk in, and the pressure that they must have felt in that moment would have been overwhelming. You would have had relatives, right, that would be angry or hurt, and you'd have some that would be understanding and some that'd be trying to figure it out, and no doubt they'd all be asking Joseph, you know, how in the world did you get in this situation? I mean, we know how you got in this situation, but how did you get in the situation that got you in the situation that you're in? Like, what? And what's Joseph going to say? Well, you see, God has this plan, and so he, yeah, okay, no. Well, if you just knew Mary, and she, see, there's no good way to say, my fiance is pregnant by God, right? There's just no way that rolls off your tongue in a conversation with friends or family or anyone where that's going to make sense. And yet, that's what they were facing. And the reality is, I think we all know what it is to face a crazy, messy life at times. We all know what it is to have somebody else's agenda drive us places we wouldn't want to go and not have control over. We all know what it is to face the complications of finances in our lives or in people we love. And we for sure all know what it is like to have family and friends where it doesn't all go smooth. Right? Especially this time of year. We know what it is to have those frustrations and those difficulties. In reality, the Christmas story is a lot more like our story than we realize. Mary and Joseph, they knew that this was a time of wonder and beauty and goodness. But on that very first Christmas, Mary and Joseph had to deal with some real disappointment and some frustration and some conflict and hard times. And I'm sure they didn't know how to navigate it all perfectly. It's interesting, Luke, when he tells the Christmas story, you know, Gavin ended with this last line in Luke's story of the Christmas story where he says, and there was no room in the inn. You know, in Greek, which the New Testament was originally written in Greek, there is a very precise word that means an inn that captures our notion of what an inn is, like a hotel or a motel. You know, when you go to a Motel 6, that's what we think of as an inn. That's not the word Luke used in the Christmas story. There's another Greek word, very precise, that is speaking of a room in a home that is a kind of living room, but is also used as a room where people would sleep. Kind of what we would think of as a guest room. When out-of-town company comes to your house, this is the room they would stay in. That is the word that Luke used. Now catch this. What Luke is saying in this moment when he says there was no room in the inn is he's saying that the young woman who is 9 months pregnant and then gives birth to that baby, that person, that baby, yeah, we didn't have space in the house for them. See, what he's really saying is there was no room in their hearts. And Mary and Joseph had to navigate that in that moment. A family who didn't know what to do with them in that moment. And no doubt it was a family in conflict over it, but it was messy. And that was the very first Christmas, friends. And so you can just see Mary and Joseph in this messy Christmas as they look into the eyes of baby Jesus and they see there this child. And every child should be celebrated. What child in any circumstance shouldn't be doted on, shouldn't be the center of attention, shouldn't be given all the preference in the world. Especially when you're looking into the eyes of a child that you know is the Messiah. But Mary and Joseph, also knowing that he was the Messiah, knew this is a glorious moment for the world. And so Luke very artfully describes as Mary takes that little baby who is the Messiah of the world and very carefully, as any mother would,
wraps and swallows him up, but then must lay him in a manger. He did come. Jesus came into this world. He came into the crazy mix of everything that makes this world this world. And what I love about the Christmas story is it shows us that God came into this world, but not as a conqueror, not as a ruler or the kind of king that needed everything his way, that everything had to be about his preference and everything had to be about honoring him for all that he deserved to be honored in. Instead, in so many ways, it wasn't about him. He came as a very humble king, didn't he?
He came as this kind of humble king with an agenda to do something beautiful and wonderful in this world. He came to bring this kind of salvation and peace and joy that transcends the craziness of this world. And what I love about the Christmas story is he comes and he brings this in the midst of all the craziness, the frustration, the hurt, all of the things that we see in our lives, that we see in the first Christmas story. He comes in the middle of that, and he knew what frustration and hurt was. And you know, I know that you can't have a group of people this large and not have a lot of us that are in moments where life is hard or difficult or bitter. And you know, sometimes life is that way. Sometimes we feel like we've got the world by the tail and the stars are lining up and meaning for life feels like it comes easy and rich and wonderful. And then in the next moment, life can feel frustrating and depressive. And that's just the mix of this world and all that is there. And I think sometimes when we feel that and we think about faith and we think about God, we think that isn't a life of faith really this thing that's all about if I can just live in such a way, you know, that right way, that God will like it so much. He'll be so pleased that he'll come down from wherever he is and he'll come into my life and he'll straighten out the mess. He'll straighten out the craziness. He'll line everything up. And sometimes we think of faith is I'll live in such a good way that God will make my life okay again and get rid of the messiness. But that's just not what Scripture teaches about what a life of faith is really all about. Life of faith isn't about the circumstances of our lives or becoming cookie cutter Christians or living in some precise way. It's about journeying with God. A God who came from up there to come into here. A God who brings a kind of salvation for something deeper than just the circumstances of our lives. See, the beauty of Christmas isn't that God came here to straighten out the messiness of the world. The beauty of the Christmas story is that God comes with strength and joy and love and salvation into the messiness of human hearts, as Scripture says, to live in human hearts. That's the beauty of the Christmas story. That is what we find and are offered in our lives. So, on this, the eve of Christmas Day, may your heart discover that your King has come, and may your soul find heavenly peace.
Well, let's all stand together to sing Silent Night as a community.
Jesus.
lift up our voices and declare this to be true. He is love and we are free. Christmas means our King has come. Let's sing it.
Love, we have found our peace. Our King has come. He is love, and we are free. He is love, and we have found our peace. Our King has come.
Christmas Eve, where we celebrate that truth in the fullness of all that it is. The idea that Jesus enters into the mess that is often our lives and yet makes it so beautiful, enters into the midst of that in such beauty and love and grace and changes everything. On this night, we ought to celebrate. And so this is the moment that I had told you about. And so if you have your phones, get those out and open up the Wham City Lights app. And it should look just like this. Here's mine. And what's going to happen in just a moment is much like what we come to declare on this night, that God is here, that light has entered the world, that the fullness of life is here amidst our mess. You, with your phones, with your voices, with who you are, in all that you are, can help us to declare the same thing as we celebrate the beauty that Christmas is here, that Jesus has arrived, and we truly have something to sing. We'll be right back.
bum, 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 bum. I played my drum for him, bum, 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 bum. I played my best for him, bum, 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 bum. Bum, 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 bum. Then he smiled at me, bum, 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 bum. In my
Christmas Eve service, right? Yeah, that's right. Hey, it has been so great to have all of you here tonight, and we just hope that God blesses you and your family. And we've talked a lot tonight about how God comes into the midst of our messiness in a real way. And what would it be like if there was a church that could live in the messiness of this kind of world? And that's the kind of church we're trying to be and seeking to be. And I want to invite you to come back in January, starting January 5th. We're going to start a series called Come As You Are. And it just might be a series that's perfect for you. And so we'd love to invite you back for that. We've got some great festivities going on outside. Take advantage of that. And let me just bless you, and then we'll be dismissed. May God just fill your heart with the love and the joy and the grace and the salvation of this season in all that he does. Amen. Amen. You have a great, great Christmas Eve. Giddy up, let's go. Let's look at the show.